Committee of the Whole Meeting of Reading City Council on this Monday, January 30th, 2023. This meeting is specific to interviewing applicants for the vacant District 5 position on City Council. We will be following a protocol that we have done before in terms of interviews and scoring processes. Joining us remotely is Councillor Chris Dalbert. Councillor Wes Butler will be joining us hopefully as soon as possible. And we have with us our councillors, Melissa Ventura, Marsha Goodman Hinerschitz, Chris Miller, and myself. This position became vacant on January 9th when I was appointed as council president. And of course, I have served in the District 5 seat for many years. We have until February 9th to fill that appointment. And we had publicly advertised for applicants for this position. We received several, and we will be interviewing the five applicants who out of those who submitted applications who are qualified to be interviewed. So as we have done before, we request anyone who has applied for the position to wait out in the hallway while we interview the applicants one by one. That's a sense of fairness to all of them. And I'll defer to our solicitor if there's any other things you'd like to say regarding this.
Sure. No, just to add to the point on the process that you've used in the past. So all of the council members have the interview score sheet, which has several categories to utilize in scoring the interview process for each of the individuals. As a reminder, I think we've used a scale of 1 to 5 for each, with 1 being the lowest and 5 being the highest, just so we have consistency there. After all of the interviews are complete, myself will tally the scores, and council can discuss that further. As a reminder, any discussion or deliberations on this topic must be done in a public meeting and is not appropriate for executive session. And the interview sheet tally scores just part of the process, or your components to take into consideration in your ultimate decision. They do not have to be the ultimate deciding factor on who you vote for when it comes down to the final appointment. Correct. And as this is a committee of the whole meeting, there is no public comment.
Councilors, any questions before we begin? Mr. Dalbert?
No questions. I'm good. Ready to go.
And we will wish Mr. Dalbert a speedy recovery on his broken leg. That is why he is with us virtually tonight. So we hope you're not in too much pain, Counselor, and we hope you recover quickly.
Thank you very much.
Just for the record, Mr. Dalbert, you do have the score sheet with you tonight, correct?
I do.
Thank you.
And you will be also, obviously, with any questions, you will certainly be participating that way.
Yeah.
So again, just reiterating, we appreciate the public's attendance, both virtually and in person. No public comment, and this is not, we ask you all to refrain from any cheering, any kind of verbal reaction to any of our applicants, our candidates here. So we will begin with Ernest Schlegel of 934 Pierce Street. Mr. Schlegel, would you like to make some opening comments?
Yes, City Council, thank you for having me here tonight for this interview for District 5. You want me to go through all comments as personal life and civic life? How do you want to do this?
Generally, we ask for the candidates to do an overview, you know, synopsize it, to think of it as a, 90-second elevator speech, 30-second? I know. Remember exactly the phraseology. Try to synopsize if you can, you know, your service here and your interest in this position.
My mother taught me as a young child to have respect, to have empathy, and to do for others. And it is by those principles that bring me here before you today. In my personal life, My experience is I was in the Army National Guard for 8 years. I was a combat MP. When leaving there, I moved to Atlanta and took a job with CNN in their security detail. And upon that, then I moved to Fort Lauderdale and opened my landscaping business, which I then sold in 2008 to move back to the city. Upon moving back to the city, I started watching BCTV and seeing how governance works. And it was by that interest that brought me into City Hall, first working on anti-discrimination ordinance in 2009 with former Councilwoman Maria Baez, District 5. We worked on that ordinance through the summer of that year in 2009. And when it got to council's table, it was to be tabled that night. And by the credit of councilors Goodman Henderschitz and Baez, they pushed that ordinance through and it passed 6-0. And was, you know, to help the LGBT community. In 2010, I was recognized for my grassroots efforts by the Pennsylvania Diversity Network, by the City of Reading, the City of Allentown, Lehigh County Executives, and U.S. Senator Arlen Specter. In those discussions during that summer of 2009, I learned that the city was going into Act 47. I also learned in those meetings that the Reading Public Library was in jeopardy of closing. So I circulated a petition and got 1,000 signatures, most of which were children of the Reading School District, and presented them to the county commissioners, which began to open a wider discussion on library services. In 2010, the dual collapse of state municipal funding put Reading Public Library in serious impact to affect other libraries in the system, because the Reading Public Library is the district center. And as so the Reading Public Library goes, the county library system fails too. So I encouraged, I was appointed to RPL in 2010. And immediately I identified funding sources and was able to raise $742,000 to repair the crumbling library buildings. I encouraged the board at that time to develop relationships with the city, state, and federal stakeholders. And this over time has reaped benefits for the library. They are doing very well today as a result of that. This helped the library expand services like internet, electronic books, and additional hours. In 2012, I was president of the board, and I was awarded the Pennsylvania Library Association's Trustee of the Year. And I was also recognized by the state Senate for my work there at the Reading Public Library. In 2014, I was appointed to the Reading Area Water Authority. And as chairman, I, along with councilors Waltman, Goodman, Henderschitz, and Acosta, negotiated a lease for the city for nearly $11 million in long-term annual sustainable lease payments. This act alone was a key element to get the city out of Act 47. Without that, we would not be getting out of Act 47 right now. On top of that, in 2015, it kept the city from doubling taxes, property taxes. As chairman of RAWA, I led the way to eliminate processing and late fees. We created more options for payment of bills, created customer appeal process, expanded bill relief process for delinquent bills with the Human Relations Commission, completely redesigned the bill for more precise billing information. We cut wasteful spending by eliminating unneeded administrative positions. The board also at that time began to break up conflicts of interest that existed at RAWA for more than 20 years. In 2019, I was appointed to the Charter Review Commission. And as part of that commission, I authored 5 referendum questions and worked with the commission to put them to the electorate, and all of them passed. So with that, That is my personal and civic life.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Schlegel. We will open it up now to counselors' questions. Anyone like to go first? Thank you.
Why do you think you're most suited for this position?
Because I have a very good knowledge of the city affairs, its budgets, its laws, and day one, I can hit the ground running.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions from the body?
I have a question.
Okay, go ahead, Councilor Daubert, then we'll go to Councilor Miller.
Thanks for being here. What do you see as the biggest problem facing District 5 right now?
Thank you, Councilman Daubert. I think the biggest issue with District 5 right now, and it's actually a citywide problem, is blight. We have to have a good blight plan, and with that blight plan has to come dollars. If we do not appropriate dollars to that, a blight plan is not going to work, because we have to understand that land is a base resource from which the community prosperity is built and sustained. It must not be squandered. If a home sits empty, unproductive for years, that is squandering of land. It is better to return it to its before state, which is a mere lot. Right now, our unspoken policy is we squander land and opportunity. Also, I think that we need to help our senior citizens by enacting a senior tax freeze. That program would be freezing taxes for senior citizens who attain age 65, who meet certain income criteria, and also homestead requirement. We need to build our tax base, and we need to take care of those who are really in need in our community. You know, our elderly are being pushed out of their homes by the constant raising of taxes. We literally, collectively, the taxing entities, have eaten through all of the rebates that seniors get. And, you know, now we're going to be forcing them out on the street. I think by doing a tax freeze for the seniors will have minimal effect on the city's income, because we already do this at Rawa. We give tax rebates. We have appeals process. So, and that net catches a whole lot more people than tax freeze does. I hope that answers your question, Councilman Daubert.
Thank you. Please keep it down in the back. Councilor Miller.
My question to you, Mr. Schlegel, and probably to all the applicants, only because I think when I applied, I didn't realize the commitment of time that would be required of a councilman compared to volunteering on some of the boards and commissions, that it goes beyond the meetings that are held in council chambers and goes out into the community. Do you feel that in your personal life you have the time necessary to be able to commit to council and to the community?
I do, Councilman Miller. You know, I can gauge that by the amount of emails I've had at the agencies that I've been head of. You know, with the library, it was over 6,000 emails. RAWA is 7,000. That takes a lot of time. And it takes a lot of time to build relationships. Relationships take time. And then all of this work that you look at, you know, especially your $100 million-plus dollar budget and budget season, it's a lot of work. And I've participated in a lot of those meetings over the years since I've been involved in city government going back to 2009. Yes, so the answer is yes to your question.
Councilor Goodman-Henderschitz.
This is somewhat of a follow-up to that question. Looking at the time involved, could you just give a brief snapshot of your understanding of what the role of the city councilor looks like weekly, and then, you know, where are the high level points of activity?
the high level activity points are going to be at your budget time. It's an inordinate amount of time. You know, to look at those numbers, you look at them till, you know, you begin to blur. That's the second part of your question. The first part of your question is,
What would a normal week look like as far as a city councilor, the activities that you'd be involved in?
You know, I know there's been a lot of jockeying back and forth. What if a councilor is part-time, if it's full-time, you know, it's full-time plus. Let's be realistic about it. You spend a lot of time at these issues and you have a tremendous amount of weight on your shoulders because you're the fiduciary stewards of the city. And with that comes time. And that is something I've committed to doing, and I have shown that I have done it.
Thank you.
Any other follow-up questions, Melissa?
What's your knowledge of the people in your district?
The knowledge of, I have ran for city council twice, and I've gone door to door, many of the doors in the district, if not probably two thirds of it. When you run for office, you know, you have to go out and knock on doors. I ran first in 2013, and then I guess in 2017. I went to Northwest Junior High School, so a lot of people that went to that junior high school, even back in my time, are still in the district. The demographics have changed. You know, my neighborhood is predominantly Hispanic, and you know, I don't want to float my boat here, but they all love me, you know, because I go out there and I spend time with them and hear their needs. And sometimes I bring them back to City Hall. But I know the entire district.
Marcia.
And beyond just attending the council meetings, the city council job has a lot of committees and such. Knowing what that looks like, where do you see yourself falling as far as your interest in serving the community? I know you spoke about being on RAWA at one point in the library, but as far as the different committees and other assignments for city councilors?
Well, I would serve wherever the council wants me to serve. I know that all of you are on committees. Being, you know, a member, if I am, I would look at where you want to put me. And I hope it's on strengths, but I'm at the will of council.
Any other questions? Melissa?
Yes. If you are granted this opportunity to serve, what's your top three priorities as a council member?
My top three priorities would be to make sure that there is a robust blight plan in place with funding. The other is to make sure that, let me take that back, to try to encourage city government, because it takes the administration to, when you talk about ordinances, to take a serious look at that senior tax freeze. Because I think it's really important at this point, because we, you know, we're forcing people out of homes. I seen that when I was at RAWA, you know, and, you know, somebody comes in and owing $25,000 worth of water bills that they can't pay. So what do you do? Because you want them to be able to have water. So you, you know, pass policy to help them. Those would be my two priorities, top priorities. And also making sure that we engage the city's youth, you know, both through activities, you know, recreation, but also civic participation. Because when we do civic participation for youth, it actually builds your workforce in the public sector and years out by engaging them.
Just a follow-up, how would you engage with the youth?
We would engage, well, you have a youth commission, so they, right now, I think, are engaged in...
But you yourself?
I would reach out to them where I could, starting with people in my neighborhood.
All right, thank you.
The other thing, if I can follow up there, Councilor Ventura, is reaching out to the schools too, because when I got the 1,000 signatures, I walked through the doors in the elementary schools and went to the, you know, the principal's office to get permission to get these signatures. So I think, you know, at a junior high level, we can do the same thing. You know, one good example of that is what the district justices are doing right now in their district court. That's a wonderful process to get the youth in to see what the legal system is, how it works, and how the office works too. Yes.
Any other follow-up questions, Chris?
You mentioned about one of your priorities would be the blight of properties in the city. Could you just go a little bit farther of what you feel or how it should be addressed by the city?
There has to be, I would think there has to be a blight plan created. It's my understanding that there may be something here right now that exists for, I guess, City Hall to look at. I have not seen it, but we need a plan that is going to, one, address the enforcement, and then when we identify these properties, which I don't know what the list stands at now, maybe 300, maybe a little under 300, those can be dealt with right now with the Redevelopment Authority through its eminent domain process. But that eminent domain process is expensive. The other thing is getting the land bank in place, whether it be in the Redevelopment Authority or, you know, the city being designated as a land bank. That has to happen, and actually that was, blight remediation was mandated in the Act 47 plan, and we did not, we exited Act 47, but we not did not adequately address that. So it would be enforcement, identifying the parcels. In the end game, what's the end use of the parcel? And how can we get people to acquire those parcels with our tools helping them? We have to partner with the end user, or as I said, you know, some of the buildings have to be demolished where they can't be rehabbed. We have to identify them and get that done now. But again, that is costly too. It comes down to dollars when we are talking about blight. We can put good tools in place, but it still needs revenue to carry that out, either by the city's general fund, by grants, both state and federal, you know, maybe even the county helping because they have their own redevelopment authority.
Any other questions? Okay, I'll just, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Marcia.
Okay. And you spoke a lot about working with different organizations. What direction do you think council needs to go as far as strengthening its collaborations with different governmental agencies and other organizations within the city?
Well, a couple things there. And I know Councilor Ventura always talks about diversity. I kind of thought you were going to ask me that question today. I wrote it down, but I can recite it out of my head. All of the organizations, you know, especially when you're dealing with the big ones like RAWA, Redevelopment Authority, Library, when we talk about diversity, when I got on the library board, it was older white men, majority. And I moved to change that. Because how the library board gets its members is from the county, from the Reading Library Company, and from the city. And each of those entities, I said, we need to widen this out and get the best minds in here. Councilwoman Superior Freitas was a benefactor of that. They brought her in, and she was like lightning. She asked a lot of questions. The same thing with RAWA when I got there. Ward was the same thing. And we brought the Honorable Maria Rodriguez in, Jalissa Espinal. That brought a lot of other minds to the table, and that's something that all of these organizations need. Not only the board, you have to understand the diversity of the board, you have to understand the diversity in the community and tap from that, and then you have to deliver a result back to the community that reflects the community.
Any other follow-up questions? I'll just conclude by thank you for being here, and I'm going to ask the same question for everyone in these forums. Appreciate your comprehensive completion of the form, and there are just two places where you do the N/A, not applicable. One is place of employment and of address, and the reason for that is?
Hired.
Okay, and also home telephone number, you have N/A.
I finally started my cell phone. I got rid of my home phone number. I was a dinosaur.
Okay, so based on all of that, everything else that you included in here, to which you've attested under, under legally is true.
Yes, so help me God.
Thank you, and thank you for your time. Thank you for your interest, and we will be in touch.
Very good, thank you.
Welcome, Mr. Nunez. We're glad you're here. And for everyone who's in the audience and virtually, our next candidate who's sitting at the table is Rafael Nunez, resides at 824 Lincoln Street within District 5. We will ask you, as we have the prior person, to give us sort of an overview of your background, your interest in this seat, a little bit about yourself personally and professionally. So the floor is yours.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I salute you, or I salute all of you. Extremely happy to stay here. It's a very honor, you know, to even speak to you about my dream and what I'm expecting. About my background, I'm I came from the Dominican Republic. I was the poorest student of my community. I did not have any chance to never get a visa, and I applied for a scholarship from school, university, what I went to, but I did not even have the chance to get anything because I was very poor. Then I decided to do my trip, and I went to a place called Mitches, and took a boat. I took this boat to Puerto Rico because I wanted to be someone. I wanted to be at least or get an associate degree. It was my dream to become a pilot and help the community. Also teach. And I took the boat just approaching Puerto Rico. The boat capsized. More than 50 people died. 13 people survived. 3 people were left in Puerto Rico because 10 people went, they weren't sent back to the Dominican, they were sent back to the Dominican Republic. And the two ladies, I saved their lives. They allowed me to stay in the United States. I never forget this experience. They told me, why are you here? I said, I am a professional in my country, but I need to be somebody here. By the time they told me that Puerto Rico was in need of professionals, and they gave me the chance and gave me the instruction to get my green card. And I did. I followed their instructions. And they told me, anytime you follow American people instructions, you will be somebody, you will succeed. And that's what I did. Then in Puerto Rico, after I get my green card, they were in need of sign language interpreter. And I worked for them. I worked for FEMA as a sign language interpreter, and they allowed me to become American citizen. And after I became American citizen, my dream was to become a pilot. And I went to Redding Area Community College once I arrived to the United States. And I have 2 degrees, 2 associate degrees from Redding Area Community College. And I also became the first pilot from that. By that time, they were the school was open for pilots. And I said that if I become a pilot, I was going to do something to help my community. And I graduated as a pilot. The first thing I did was to fly the kids. All of you have heard about Christmas in the air. I am one of those who fly planes. And I, at the beginning, we were flying from 200 to 500 kids, and 26 people have become pilots at this time. And they are doing the same thing I did, helping the community. After I went to Alvernia University and got my bachelor's degree, plus I finished my master's degree, so also became a psychotherapist. I have a master's degree as a psychotherapist also. I'm specialized in several careers, like kids, adolescent, and some more. Also, because of the job I have been doing for the community for more than 20 years, the University of Florida have given me a honorary doctorate degree. So I became a doctorate degree. All my careers in the United States have been used to help the community. Not only Latino people, but the whole community, American people. As you know, I was a member of the Police Diversity Board, and Chief Hines was here, and I worked with them helping the community. I received several awards from New York. I'm talking about from 300 to 400 awards due to the job I have been doing for the community. I teach English Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. I teach sign language. I teach citizenship classes. And also help the community to translate the titles. And pretty much have been working for my community very, very hard. And every week, if anyone who could be able to see my Facebook, from 5 to 10 people become American citizens. I have my own school. It's free of cost. I don't charge any cent for my school because I promise that if I get at least an associate degree from the United States, I was going to dedicate my life to help the community. And that's pretty much what I do. After I finish here, I'm going to teach English. I also have taught Spanish to some authorities that I'm not allowed to tell. And I'm a very respectful and well-known person as a translator for the Department of Immigration. I have my my certification here in my hand, in my pocket. And I also do sign language. And pretty much that's it about what I'm doing. So I would say that I have done more GED classes than any school here because that's what I teach every day. I also teach sign language, but it's the only, every 3 months I graduate some people. And you ask me, Honorable, about why do I need this position? Yes. It is my dream to serve the community. It is my dream to see people happy. As a Latino, I'm not looking only to help my Latino community. I am looking to help the whole community the same way I did when I was member of the Board of Election, when I was member of the Police Diversity Board, and I worked too close with he's a chief, Chief Hine, but also he was a captain here, Power. He's the chief of police from West Reading. And most of you here know my job helping the community. And Honorable Reed, I'm very proud of you. As I said always, I'm not looking for it. I'm telling you the truth because I run against you. But you always won because you do a great job. You are very honest. And it's my job to congratulate you always. And pretty much that's, anytime I see you, I always tell you I am proud of you, but I'm proud that I'm here today. So if you have any questions, I'm here.
Okay, well, thank you for the presentation, your kind words. I'll open it up to our council members for questions. Who would like to go first? Mr. Daubert, would you like to go since you're virtually here?
Sure. Thank you for being here. What do you see as the biggest issues in your district that city council has direct jurisdiction over, that city council can directly address?
Well, I will do two things. Well, first of all, we have that you probably don't know, we have a huge deaf community in my district that nobody's paying attention. And I'm looking to see if we have a chance to work with the community and with as a city council to do some project to have this community also learn sign language. And that part also will include some things for the police department. I want the police department include someone who knows sign language, and I have the way to do it. The other one is the education. I want to see everyone being well educated, but my main concern is just the safety of the kids. I would like to educate the people of my community about the importance of driving correctly, to respect when they drive. Also, avoid people and explain people, educate people about what we call jaywalking, because several accidents have happened. And Honorable Reed knows that we had a huge bad accident, but I would like to continue working with the education of the kids. I also want to motivate the students from the school, because they need leaders. They need to see examples. They need to see that our community is, we have the best community, but we need to do something that could enforce the safety of them, but also the education.
Councilor Daubert, any follow-up to that before we go forward?
No.
Other questions from our councilors around the table? Councilor Miller?
Thank you for applying. I've asked this question, and I plan to ask all applicants. And obviously, from your presentation, you're a very busy person. You're involved with a lot of different things. Do you feel that the time that's required to serve on council, which goes beyond the meetings on Monday night, it goes much farther dealing with the community, does your schedule permit you to?
Definitely, Honorable. I will switch my schedule because I could teach Tuesday instead of Monday, because what I do not want is to leave my community without learning English, without also the other community, American community, who without learning Spanish. And I can switch that. Yes, it's not, if I become a city council, definitely, you know, I will have time to serve, because it is my dream even to stay here, but to serve the community from here.
Any follow-up, Chris? Thank you. Marcia?
Okay, looking at the responsibilities of a person from on city council, what would an average week look like as far as what responsibilities you might have both to city council and to the community?
Or what the first of all, we're here to apply the rules, to review the local laws, and pretty much what I will do with my community. So if you can, because I'm like, can you repeat the question for me?
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, your responsibilities both here legislatively.
Yes.
Okay, and also to the community. What would you look? What would a typical week look like for a city councilor?
Oh, well, I will do pretty much, I will check the community, what is in need of our community, and we'll do proposals.
You answered my questions, but thank you for applying.
Okay.
I don't have any questions.
Oh, thank you.
Question, we've known each other for some time. I know you certainly know the area, the Glenside area. Can you talk about some of the other areas of the city, District 5, that you can see the needs and you're aware of?
A need? Well, plus District 5, yeah, we are the whole city already in. Yeah, we need help. If it is a question, yes, we only, but I'm not planning only to work within District 5. Bevan, I'm not going to, I'm so respectful with the law, but also respectful with the districts. I'm not going to do something that is not correct, because if in case I need to do something for other district, definitely, you know, I will first ask to the person in charge. That, but yes, we all, the whole community already, we need services. I'm working with the community. I'm teaching English in 531 Canal Street, but also sometimes they call me to teach in one church from District 6, District 1, and I do it. So I work with the whole community. I know pretty much, I think I'll probably be limited because I will be in District 5. But it is my plan to serve the whole community. I have done it for 22 years and I would like to continue doing it. Do you imagine me as a city council, what I can do for the community? Wow.
Hey, go ahead, Melissa.
How many people have you helped become a citizen?
Thousands. If from thousands. If you see my Facebook, even today, two more people. This week, I have six people who will become American citizens. I have more than 30 students, but I also teach to professionals Spanish and about GDs and citizen, yes, but thousands, I would say thousands. It is, I don't want you to see me wrong, but nobody here in the city of Reading had talked or translate more citizenship classes than me, nobody, 22 years.
Any other questions from counselors?
Marsha.
Thanks. That's all right. So when we talk about our role in council beyond just voting on legislation, we're also assigned to a lot of different committees, a lot of other responsibilities. Do you give me your sense of what your knowledge is of other work that we do as far as committee specific, and then what your interest might be? And I think you did speak earlier about your interest in the deaf community, which—
First of all, you are the legislators. And that's pretty much what I will do. I will work close to you, exactly doing it what you do, so.
Thank you.
Okay, anything else from anyone? Mr. Daubert, I wanna acknowledge Mr. Butler joining us. Mr. Butler, any questions for Mr. Nunez?
No questions.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Butler. I want to thank you for your comprehensive completion of your application here. And I'm going to ask the same questions as I have anyone else, that I don't see anywhere that you've put non-applicable for any of the questions. You've answered them yes or no, and to what was requested. So I'm just verifying with you that everything you've answered here stands as you completed it on form, as you've attested to it. Correct?
Sure.
Okay. Well, we thank you and we will be in touch, and we appreciate your service to the community and your interest in applying for the District 5 position. So thank you very much. And I'm sure you have class to teach, so we appreciate your helping everyone else.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you for being here, Ms. Perez, and for everyone who is in attendance, both physically and virtually. We are now interviewing our third candidate for this position, and that is Sheila Perez of the address of 336 West Douglas Street. And we will ask you, as we've asked everyone else, to sort of give an overview of your interest and your experience, and then we will go on to council questions.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for having me, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here. My interest in becoming city council and to be nominated in the city council position is the passion to make Reading as good a place as any to live. Throughout the years, I have been, over the past 20 years, I have been very involved within city government. I've actually participated in numerous council meetings. I've addressed public the public during council meetings. I've also conducted my own surveys, my own studies. I have additionally have been appointed to the Home Rule Charter Commission. I was a member of the Home Rule Charter Board Commission, the Home Rule Charter Commission, Review Commission in 2001 and also in 2018-2019 year. In addition to that, I also participated, I was a participant and part of the chairman of five committee as it pertained to citizens initiatives, which included the two term limits as well as the toxic trespass, freedom from toxic trespass. And I also participated in the census. So I have no problems going door to door because it allowed me and it motivated me to actually get to know the people in our communities, not just in District 5, but across the city. It allowed me to hear their concerns, to see their issues and speak to them firsthand one-on-one as of their desires, as what they would like to see happen, what concerns they have or the problems that they have. And being an advocate, I have been fortunate enough to have assisted them and in resolving a lot of those issues. So I welcome the opportunity. I know it's a challenge. I know it's not an easy task. But I'm up for it.
Okay, we will defer to councilors' questions. Mr. Daubert, would you like to start?
Sure. Thank you very much for being here. What do you think are the biggest issues affecting District 5 that City Council would have direct jurisdiction over right now?
Some of the biggest issues in District 5 is the overcrowding, the parking. That I would start off with that. Parking has become a bear, and it's not an easy task to resolve. It's not an issue that is easily resolvable. But we need to be, I guess, a little bit more empathetic towards the needs of the people in that district. The individuals within the district, they have many concerns. The concerns of landlord-tenant issues, many landlords are neglecting their tenants. Overall improvement within the district and engagement, I guess engaging the people, because until we know and we truly know the people within District 5 and understand their concerns and see where their minds are at, we won't be able to truly effectively address the issues that and highly impact the individuals within District 5. So I would say that besides parking is engagement. There's little to no engagement in the government when it comes to the people there. So having town meetings, town hall meetings, utilizing the Water Authority for notices to the public of those meetings, having those meetings both in English and in Spanish, outreach and education is very important, because if 70% of the population is Hispanic speaking and those individuals aren't educated in their language about the issues, about the proposals of resolutions or ordinances that will highly impact them, then there's no engagement. You know, I firmly believe that education drives passion and passion drives change. So in order for you to get the change that we're looking for, we need to educate and get the people involved.
Thank you. Any follow-up, Councilor Daubert?
No, not at this time.
Okay, thank you. Melissa?
If granted if you were to have the ability to serve as council, what's your top three priorities?
Engagement of the public, outreach and education, truly involving the community, bringing those issues to them, and hopefully having through that alliance, bringing them out to us. One of the things that I could say that I truly enjoyed was the change that I saw within the blocks in terms of block cleanups and block parties. Ryan Bradley, he lives not too far from where I live. And we always worked together. We were very involved to doing community cleanups. And what I saw was how the blocks now would reach out to us, because they wanted us to do what we were doing in their areas. So, you know, reach one, teach one, right? Or reach one, teach one. And that would be one of my top priorities, is bringing the community together, outreach and education through outreach and education, and the parking issue. Figure out a better way to address that issue at hand. It's detrimentally affecting everyone, right? It's not just an issue for the constituents. It's also an issue for the city, because we have a large volume of people. We have landlords that are converting row homes into multi-unit apartments, and there's no way to handle the parking spaces. Then we have also the grocery stores who have now become restaurants. So people aren't just going in for 5 minutes and buying things and leaving. They're waiting for their food to be serviced. So there, it's impact, highly impacting the residential parking at hand. So that would be, to me, the top three priorities.
Thank you.
Mr. Butler, any questions you might have?
Yes, hi, Sheila.
Hi.
My question is, I'm sorry. Can you guys hear me?
We can hear you, Wes.
Okay. My question is, what skills do you have that will help City Council successfully achieve its purpose?
Well, I'm devoted. I'm a go-getter. I'm a researcher. I go door to door. I compile information, because unless we do that, we really can't fix the issues. We really can't begin to have the empathy that we need to deal effectively address that. The past 20 years, I would hope, would be motivation enough to prove to this council how devoted I have been to helping resolve bring our concerns forward and hopefully having them somewhat addressed. I'm involved, I'm committed, and I would hope that council would see that, because I know that you've heard enough from me over the past 20 years, and I don't anticipate that dying down.
Any follow-up, Wes?
No, thank you.
Okay, going around the table. Marcia, Chris? Marcia?
Sure. Hi, Sheila.
Hi, Marcia.
So, and you've been coming to a lot of council meetings, so you have some idea, you know, obviously what we do legislatively. If you would look at the week in the life of a city councilor, could you describe what that might look like as far as both in here in City Hall and outside in the community?
Well, I mean, the life of a city councilor is not an easy job. Many people assume that, but when you have to read legislations that you're going to be approving, attending council meetings, I mean, you're here, you have the committee of the whole meeting that prepares you for the council meetings, where you discuss in the committee of the whole meetings, there's lots of, you know, table discussions on the proposed ordinances and resolutions. Also, in terms of attendance and activities that you're invited to, or kind of State of the Union addresses, things of that nature, including your weekends. So it's a pretty hectic life. It's not an easy life, but I think it's a fulfilling life, because when you see your hard work being utilized and for the betterment of the community, I mean, it becomes a win-win. I believe it helps enhance the camaraderie between the legislative government and the people.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Miller.
Thank you for applying.
Thank you.
Your presentation, you've made it very clear that you feel that people are the priority in the communication. But my question is, the city as a whole, not just District 5, but the three issues that you see as a city, what would you be talking to the people about that you yourself see as issues that need to be addressed? And I know you did say parking, but are there any other issues that you feel are major that need to be looked at?
Well, absolutely. I mean, our budget, in order for us to be able to provide, we have to take a look at how to best manage the budget. The economic impact or any barriers that are that are stopping the economic development or have become barriers against our ability to be able to economically evolve. I think over the past, this is my personal opinion, and I'm not faulting anyone for it, but when we focus community and economic development, it's not just structural development. especially if that structural development entails development of nonprofit organizations, because they don't pay taxes here. The people do, right? So how do we economically grow our tax base, right? How do we grow in order to be able to provide effectively? Managing that is what I think is one of the most difficult tasks that the city government has to deal with. I'm hearing there's people have a vision. Many people invest in properties because they want to develop them, no different than the nonprofit developer does. So let's create a program that's going to assist them in developing those properties so that we grow the tax base, not deplete the tax base. I think that's one of the key issues facing us right now is the economics of the city, the budget. Coming out of Act 47 and maintaining that base to stay out of Act 47 is going to be a challenging task that we have to face. And how we, what we can creatively come up with to benefit everyone as a whole and not take away from this person or give to Rob from Peter to give to Paul, but cohesively work together to still achieve the outcome that we're looking for. That's what we need to have a mindset. You know, most global companies, the most effective, the most successful global companies are global companies that embrace everyone, the cultures. Why? Because not everybody is of the same mindset. And as a result of that, the brainstorming, what people do together, I've seen it. What people can, what the creativity that comes along with global inclusiveness is amazing. It helps people soar. And until we do that and accept that and commit to effectively including everyone in that dilemma, we won't get out of where we are now. We need to be more inclusive and look to other people for solutions, for ideas, in order to be able to come up with, you know, the right mix.
Any follow-up, Councilor Miller? Question, you're certainly seasoned, you've been around a long time, and as many of us have in this city governance.
I'm sorry, Donna, I didn't hear that last.
I said through city governance, you've been observing, you've been aware of it for a long time. You noted that you were active in census, and I'm assuming going back to census 2000, 2010, 2020, in the redistricting efforts for the city districts, District 5 is the only one that hasn't been redistricted, change of precincts to a different district, whatever. Why do you think there is that stability in District 5? What would you credit that to?
Maybe District 5 as a whole has a huge constituency that is located within the row homes. You gotta give me some time to think on that one, because you're absolutely right where the district in District 5 hasn't really changed much. And when it has changed, it's only been up like a block or two, you know.
Actually, I don't think it's even changed that much.
Yeah.
I think it stayed consistent over the years.
No, it has. It has changed, because I remember where the lines were up on North Front Street, and then Prior to that, it had been someplace else because I've been in the district for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's I'm committed. I've been. That's another thing. My 30 years of living in the city, it's been in District 5. Why the districts having changed? I guess that would be a question for the Planning Commission.
I just asked regarding you mentioning census, and I appreciate your involvement in that because that's very, very, very critical, as you know, for funding. So we appreciate that you have taken that.
Yes, and it's very difficult. The good thing about is getting out with the people, because let me tell you something, going out in the census and convincing the people to participate, that was like pulling teeth. And the importance of why and how much money we lose. I don't think people are aware the funding that we get per person. And that's what keeps us afloat.
I appreciate those thoughts.
And so, you know, breaking it down to them, first of all, layman's terms, that's another critical thing. When the government makes it so complex that people don't understand it in layman's terms, they don't get involved. But once you break it down, they're more open now. They see me walking. Oh, here you. Oh, yes, no problem. What do you have? Time? Absolutely. You know, they have no problem. Then, oh, wait, why don't you go down the block, go across the street, tell them I sent you. That's how you begin to create the camaraderie. You break it down for them in their terms. Once you break it down, the barriers, those language barriers, that's key, whether it's in English, because it is complex and most people don't like to let inform individuals that they're not as knowledgeable. And it's not that they're ignorant. It's just that, you know, the degrees of education aren't there. And honestly, for me, there are times where I have to just look up a word because it is a bit complex for me. So if it's complex for me, we need to find a way to break it down, because by breaking it down, again, it's education, right? Education drives passion, and the passion is what drives the change. I've seen it in terms of cooperation, and when I go door to door from the individuals and how they embrace me. I feel comfortable and I feel safe in my neighborhood. I feel safe in my city. I walk the streets at 2 a.m. I will walk the streets by myself. People think I'm crazy, but when you know and you actually, and the people get to know you, there's no reason to fear, because they are watching your back and they do care. We just have to find, you know, a way to reach them so that we can both be on the same plateau.
Any follow-up questions, Melissa?
I can hear your passion, and thank you.
Thank you.
Tell us why you're so passionate.
I think I inherited that. my grandfathers both were very political activists in Puerto Rico. I didn't realize that. My parents emigrated from Puerto Rico, and I saw firsthand how people treated my mother, you know, and how they pretended, and how my mother, because she didn't speak English, I had to relay messages to individuals. And as badly as I didn't want to say, because I felt it was rude, she was fighting for her rights. So I learned to, you know, what's right is right. And when people abuse those rights, or when people treat individuals differently because of the color of their skin, or when, you know, when the economic barriers exist, not because we want them to, but because that's the way it's designed. It's not because we're lazy, because there's some of your hardest working people are the poor people. And we need to understand that. So my passion comes from fighting all my life. I have a brother who's mentally challenged, physically challenged. So it was challenging for us to, as we were growing up, you know, my parents never gave up, never put him in a home. And we all worked together to make it work. The passion is there. It's what drives me. It's in my blood. It's in my blood. It's in my ancestors. I'm sorry, but I hope that you understand.
Any other questions from the body? I'll just follow up on the same questions that I've asked the other candidates. We appreciate your application and your filling out of it, your completion of it. We are asking the same questions of everyone. Where it says place of employment and address, that's blank. Are you self-employed?
Yes.
Okay, so that's why that's blank.
Yes. Okay.
Then there are two other places. Question 12, do you own any properties or businesses in the city? If so, please list. You put not applicable. You know, no other properties in the city?
No, there's two other properties.
Why was that not completed?
Pardon me?
Why was that not completed?
Because if I'm elected, I will be more than happy to fill out a statement of financial interest. But for this process, the only thing that the city charter says that we have to do under section 202 is be 18 years of age, live in the city for in the district for a year. And I forget what the third one is, but it doesn't ask you for your for you to list the list of properties that you have.
Okay, and you also put N/A regarding sewer water bills, property taxes.
Right, because it's not a criteria that's necessary. Okay. I don't believe any of you had to fill out that criteria when you ran. So it shouldn't be a criteria that should be held for any nominations.
Okay, we're posing the same questions to everyone.
Okay.
Okay, any other follow-ups, Marcia?
Yeah, just, and thank you for providing your driver's license.
You're welcome.
A different address on your driver's license and where you say you reside?
Yes.
So which is the correct address?
The 336.
Okay.
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 Okay, well, thank you for your interest. We appreciate your application and we will be in touch.
Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Thank
you. Great evening. Thank you for the opportunity.
I assume he does. You better have him.
Can I stay here or must I leave?
No, we ask everyone to.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. I just sent it out to him. Okay. Yeah. Okay. We were just, say that again. Just waiting for our city clerk to return and we'll get started.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, let's see. Thank you.
Okay, we're back from our little break here, and we want to welcome Wanda Negron from the 300 Lackawanna Street in Reading. We appreciate your interest in this position. We're glad you applied, and we will start as we did with the other candidates. We ask you to offer sort of an overview of yourself and your personal and professional background and why you're interested in this position. So again, welcome and thank you for your interest.
Thank you. Okay, first to start saying, as myself, I am a truthful, honest, and sincere person. I love my neighborhood. I love to help out the people out there, for us, the constituents. And I've been around, involved in many politics circles, helping out people out there, candidate, and I've been hearing and listening to the people as what they want. And as they need help with, I refer them, I talk to them, and my only main concern is always about them. So basically, that's what I stand sometimes on the side doing, involved in the community. I also get involved with outreach program, helping out the homeless. As for me, I can tell you that I was born and raised in Puerto Rico. I went to New York, and I was raised there the rest of the time. Then I came to Reading. I made Reading my town, my city right now, okay? This is where I live. This is where I reside. This is what I think I'm gonna stay until the day I'm gone. So my concern is wanting for the city what a lot of us want for the city. And a lot of us want the best for the city. I mean, so back then it used to be beautiful, profitable places I saw when I first came in. People will say hi when you walk by. I got scared once when someone said hi to me because, you know, I never thought it would be like that, like living in New York in a hustle and bustle. But when I saw somebody, hi, and I'm like, you know, what's this? So that was back then. But what I seen as time went by, as the year went by, it has been a great change. And I know as for what I hear, for what I read, for being involved, that the city council has a lot of power to make a change and the outcome and the development of this city. And I want to be part of it. That's the reason that I'm interested, because I want to be part of the change. I want to be able to voice my opinion. I want to be able to discuss about what can and cannot be done about, what is right, what is wrong, and how we can come in an agreement in accordance to plan and to do what's best for the city, which is right now that what we should be thinking about. And this is why I'm thinking about being part of the city council. For what is as little as I know, I'm not so well, very well educated, but I always been involved in the politics and I always like part of it. Then I've been like the one behind the back burner when all of the candidates are going out there. I mean, I wanted to run for many offices way back then, even for city council a long, long time ago, you know, and I stood back. One of the objects was because, you know, I felt a person that was in this position was good enough that I didn't want to, you know, be against this person. I always have my utmost respect for this person, you know what I mean? So, but right now the seat is open. And I think for being involved in the community and being part of the community that I could give back a lot of it, what it has given me, a place to I could call home. This is what I feel about city council.
Thank you, I appreciate that. And we'll open it up now to our councilors for questions. Mr. Dauber, would you like to lead?
Sure, thank you very much for being here. I'd like for you to express what you think the biggest issues affecting District 5 are that you will have jurisdiction over if you were on council. So you would be able to actually do something about it.
Okay, one big issue right now, it might not seem pointless or anything, but I drive around, and I know maybe we could do some kind of help about this. I do drive around, and one issue that I think is great, that maybe perhaps we could get involved in this, I don't know, because I don't know yet exactly what is it entail, what does the job entails until I get, you know, pointed at, and then I will be instructed, indicated about it. But one thing that I personally believe and I feel that if the city council can get involved and fix out those streets, there are too many potholes in there. I'm sorry, but I had to say that. There are too many potholes. And that's what I think for now. But other than that, I think District 5 is at a peaceful time. I don't see and I don't hear of a lot of crime, and I don't hear about a lot of discord and disorderness. I mean, it's been peaceful to me. I'm comfortable where I am. And I believe that a lot of us are comfortable where we are in this area. It's not so much crime in this area, it's out here in many other areas. And I will unite with other areas so that what we could do to help out other areas. And sorry to say, you know, can make this greater area as District 5 is. Sorry.
Any follow-up, Chris?
No, thank you.
If you're granted this opportunity to serve, what would be your top three priorities as a council member?
First foremost is the crime. I mean, I have stood in the corner and fight, you know, to fight this violence that I so much, you know, read about and hear about. And we got really tough in it. And the best way to get done with is we need to get more policy, you know, policing out there, the police enforcing there. Because as I read every morning, I hear the news, you know, down in other states it's bad. But then when I hear the news and I read the news over here the weekend, are very bad. And we need to do something about this crime. We really need to do something. Because besides of it all, and what I think, coming from where I'm coming from, Reading is a beautiful city. It is. And we can make it even prettier than what it is right now.
Melissa,
and second.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, first and foremost, besides the crime, there's a problem going around. I don't have no children at the school right now. You know, my kids are grown. I saw a kid, we were driving in a cab, and then I saw a kid pulling out a gun, showing it to another kid. I got hysterical. I called the police department. Look, this is going on. So I got, you know, the ball rolling, you know. I was really hysterical about that situation. And for what I hear, like I said, I don't have no kids in school, but I hear from many other people, other parents, what's going on in school. You know, the bullying, a dedication, a time spent, not enough caring, not enough studying, not enough that they should have back when I was going to school. And maybe a lot of us was going to school. You know, it's not appreciative right now. I mean, I love going to school. I wish I was again in fifth grade. Okay, so what's going on here for what I hear is the education and what's happening in Reading. And Reading High School is a pretty good castle, like they call it the castle in the hill, you know? And we need to think about that place also as well. It's a lot of areas, a lot of schools, you know? My heart, it is right here. I don't live out of the city. I live here in the city of Reading. So my concern is the city of Reading. And the education is one very important thing. And as for another issue that we need to tackle is the youth. We need to get involved more and develop some kind of a program for the youth. Like I have an experience right now where I work with the elderly. I mean, they should have a program like that developed for the youth. It would be great. But that's another point, another subject we could touch later on. That's a good idea that I have, but stays here.
Thank you. Marcia, or is Chris next, whoever would like to go? Okay.
Thank you for applying. I've asked all the applicants basically the same question. And one of the reasons is I was a little surprised when I came on council, and that was the time commitment, in addition to the Monday meetings that may not necessarily be required, but it is expected that you be out in the community, and there are usually additional meetings. Do you feel that in your schedule that you will have time for the amount of time that it takes to be on council?
Well, one thing that I studied and I'm very good at is time management. So if I could dip here, and then I put first, second, and third, like when I go shopping, say, I gotta go here, gotta go here, gotta go there. And I do it, even though I'm not written to-do list, but right here, this is what I'm gonna do in the order I'm gonna do it. So if particularly there is a time and a moment that I have to make sure that I'm committed to that, I make sure I be committed to that. And if anything come hinder and whatever, this is what is important because I already put it in my agenda. So this is how I feel about it.
Okay, thank you. Marcia?
Okay, and a follow-up to that question is council members have a lot of responsibilities. From what you know about being a city councilor, what do you think a week in the life of a city councilor is like with the work we do in City Hall and then the work we do out in the community? Like, how would you see yourself spending your time?
Well, as it is right now, I spend my time, whatever free time that I can, is talking to the people and the public and their needs and outreach and helping out. So I will spend time as like I am doing right now, reaching out to the people that basically I'm doing without no assignment, no job or whatever. I do it because that's what I like to do.
Okay. What do you see having to do here when you're in City Hall, though? What kind of work or responsibilities do you see if you sit at this table being a city councilor? What work do you have to do in City Hall?
I lost you.
Really. Okay, just describe what you see the responsibilities of the city councilor when they're here working with our legislative responsibilities.
What do I see or what?
What kind of responsibilities do you see?
Well, for that responsibility that I know, it's like you have a tough decision when you have to make a decision for what other people do want. So it's a tough decision that I will have to come together and agreeable with everybody that we could come to a conclusion that what is best.
Right. Yes, that's very helpful. Thank you.
Mr. Butler, any questions?
Yes. Hi, Wanda.
Hi.
Thanks again for applying. My only question that I've asked, well, one person so far, but I plan to ask everybody, what skills do you have that will help City Council successfully achieve its purpose?
Okay, numero uno, which they always say, I'm bilingual. Where they always come, oh, she's bilingual. The other skill that I have, I mean, I have worked in the county, plenty of jobs. I have worked at the courthouse, domestic relations. I have been an interpreter for the judges, especially back Ehrlich, Judge Ehrlich. She was a good person, a friend of mine. Judge Luggate, I serve as an interpreter in the court. So I know a little bit about the law here and there, little pieces, you know, piece in the parts. I work in the community, customer service, deal with the public. Right now I work at a Berks Latino workforce where we recruit people to get educated, more educated and further themselves in education, learning, English as second language and nursing and other programs. So what else? Lost my thought. Okay. And what else can I say? I mean, there's a lot. I think I could go on and on and on by myself. But the thing about me is I'm sincere and I'm eager to help. I just help at no matter, you know, the time or the frame and whatever I can do help others. And it is part of this council and part of the community and part of the government should be, but to help one another, to entail together, to be united. You know, we are the United States of America, not the divided states of America. We are to be united.
Wes, any follow-up?
No, that's all. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I think that's interesting. I think that's an advice that could be given to the Congress and the state government right now. So you might want to write a letter to representatives on a federal and state level.
Yeah, it's not the United States of America, the divided states of America. Yeah,
it's certainly something that I think sometimes local governments are better at than maybe those people who are above us. You know what I mean? Question, we've asked the same thing of everyone. Number one, we appreciate how well you've and completely you've filled out your forms, but we are asking folks where you have N/A not applicable, just to please clarify that if you would. And one of those is employed by the city of Reading. Have you ever been employed by the city? You have N/A there, not applicable. Did you mean?
Oh, no, not applicable.
Okay.
Yeah, not by the city of Reading. I work by the county, which right. is domestic okay. relation. Is not yeah. the city.
I'm just clarifying for.
Oh, the non-applicable.
And then provided goods or services for the city over the course of time. U of N/A there is.
Yeah.
Is that, would that be yes or no?
No.
No. And then you've not served on any city board authority or commission?
No.
Okay, we just want to clarify.
See, because I know with the last minute I was told, so I had to hurry up because I didn't want to miss this opportunity. I didn't even get to finish and put my resume together that I would have submitted. So I had to do it, you know, really fast
sure,
and everything.
Sure.
I mean, I even had to correct that one. That's the second page I had done it.
Okay.
But I didn't want to miss this opportunity.
Sure. And then number 12, owning any properties or businesses in the city?
No.
And any delinquent water, sewer, property taxes, things like that?
No.
Okay. Okay. We just want to clarify. We ask the same thing of everyone. So thank you. Any final statements you'd like to make?
Statements? No, but I do have a question. Maybe you could help me on this. And maybe try to remember, how was it when you first went through the same process I'm going through? Do you know how nervous I feel right now? You know, and it's like one that, you know, you had. How you've been there already, how it is that I'm here, and to get there, imagine how I'm gonna be when I get there, when I do, whenever I get there. So it's like, I put myself in your shoes, put yourself in my shoes.
I'm sure, and we appreciate that fact with everyone who's applied, and I'm sure Councillor Miller, who most recently sat in the seat you're sitting in, can attest to how that feels when we're asking you questions.
Yeah, how does that feel?
But I guarantee you, I believe to a person, we are all grateful that you've taken the efforts to apply, your service to the city and your service to the community. So I think that's something we can all have a consensus.
Yeah, I was still working out there in the campaign. No matter what, I still be a servant
sure.
to the community, because if anything I could say, good voice and good pass around, that would be fine. So it's not going to make any mm-hmm. dent on my side. If not, mm-hmm. I would still be part of the community, helping out the community.
Right. Well, we appreciate everything. And thank you very much
for
coming in.
Thank you for
having me. Thanks for everything you do.
Oh, I do have a question. Sorry. When do we know the decision?
Within the week. Okay.
Okay, I get my own mic.
We're just going to wait until our city clerk gets back so everybody can take a little breath here. Okay. Okay. And just for everyone's edification, what we're looking at here is we get these papers. We have simply asked those folks who had not submitted their driver's license or ID to do so as part of the form. So that's happened, I believe, for three or four of our candidates. So we're just doing that consistently. So we are at our fifth candidate for this position. So we welcome you, Mr. Lesher. Thank you for joining us. And this is Walter C. Rusty Lesher of 2309 River Road in the city of Reading. And I believe you say you've lived at the address for 39 years. So we thank you for your interest in this position. We'll ask you the same questions we asked everyone, which is please give us a synopsis of your personal and your professional life to give us an idea of your, you know, of yourself, and also what has spurred your interest in this open position. Again, welcome. Thank you. And the floor is yours.
Should I just start out with my basic working life?
However you want to synopsize your professional, personal.
Okay.
Background.
I've been in management all my life, probably about 40 years or so, and I enjoyed it. I enjoyed working with people all the time. As far as my knowledge of city government, it's not much. But my ex-wife at one time was the zoning officer for the city of Reading, and then she became head of the DID for a while, and we were together at that time, so I got a little bit familiar with some of the workings. as far as why I want to be here, it's an opportunity to help the city of Reading. Basically, that's what I'm interested in. Environmentally, my son is an environmental engineer out in Seattle, which I hope I influenced him somewhat on that. And also concerned about the drug problem in the city of Reading. My daughter spent 13 years as a heroin addict, so I know firsthand what that's about. I mean, it was horrible. Now she's been clean. It'll be 10 years in November, so I'm really proud of her. I hope something can be done about it, because the addicts, it's a disease. For the pusher, it's a business. I'd like to see them shut down. So. But I can't think of anything else that I could tell you about myself. I wasn't totally mentally prepared for this. I've only been on maybe three interviews in my entire life for jobs, because people always came to me and said, "I want to work for you." And I did, but I think I could help the city with all my management type experience that I had. And right now I own my own business. I have a limousine, and basically it's to supplement my Social Security. I'm 69 years old. I didn't want to work a lot, but I know this is a lot of work, as you could probably tell me. And I just think that I could help.
Okay.
Many different areas.
Okay. Well, we'll proceed and ask you questions, and don't be nervous. Everyone's nervous who sits there.
Oh, right? I am.
But you know, we're all here in this. We're all in this together, as they say. So please don't be nervous. So, Mr. Daubert, I'll defer to you as we have along the way.
Sure. Thank you very much for being here. My question is, what do you see as the biggest problems facing District 5 that, as council, you'd be able to maybe make things better?
Well, I drove through the city yesterday morning, you know, through that district area, and I saw a lot of parking problems. Clean up, there's trash, you know, different areas. Some areas are much cleaner than others, but there are some areas that need to be addressed for the trash pickup. And I thought that when we went to one service for the trash pickup, that things would be a little bit cleaner, and I don't know if it actually is. That's basic areas that I see without really getting into it.
Any follow-up, Chris? Any follow-up, Chris Daubert? Marsha, I'll defer to you.
Yeah, and just to explain to Mr. Lesher, the people that are talking are on Zoom, so that's why you don't see them.
Okay.
I know you were looking, and it was, yeah. So their voices are coming off of that screen. So that's
That's great.
So there's two of us that are like that. We're so used to it that unless you're accustomed to Zoom meetings, it gets a little disconcerting. So, from your understanding of city government, what do you think the roles and responsibilities are of a city councilor?
To help develop regulations for different areas to make sure things get done properly. Or I guess it's sort of the legislation area. I'm not entirely familiar with everything that happens. I know there's a lot that's involved with each district, and each district I think has same basic problems. But in District 5, you know, it doesn't. I know Riverdale is a very clean area, but we have people going through with Amazon, and I see them throwing trash right out the window of their car. I mean, I witnessed it. And as far as the role of council, I'd like to see, you know, the police get more involved in some of the things.
If you are granted this opportunity, what would be your top three priorities as a council member?
Top three priorities of, excuse me. Well, environmental areas. The drug situation, which I don't think it's too much of a problem in this Riverdale area, but I see it other areas. Another top third would be the parking situation, and it should be, we could take the empty lots and that the city owns and create parking areas for people. You're welcome.
Mr. Miller?
Thank you, Mr. Lesser, for applying. I've asked this question of everybody that's applied only because as the new kid on the block, I was a little bit surprised because I was aware of city council meetings on Mondays, but there was a lot that I wasn't aware of. And I just wanna make sure that everybody has a good understanding that in addition to council meetings, council of the whole, there are several things that happen in the community where it's not a requirement, but it's certainly expected that you be there. And also with your constituents in your district,
right,
there are times where you'll need to have meetings. In your business, with your schedule, do you feel that you'll be able to fulfill the full requirements of being a counselor for the city?
Yes, is my job involves maybe 20 to 30 hours a week at the most. And it's all spread out. It's unpredictable when I'd be going. But my girlfriend helps me out driving. She drives for me when I can't or when I have something else going on. And I have a list of other people, friends that can drive. So I can get filled in. But I wanted to come to the meeting last week, but I had an elderly person that I had to pick up and he only trusts me to pick him up. So, but I took care of that.
Anything else, Chris? Chris, anything else? Okay. Mr. Butler?
Yes. My question of first, hi, and thank you for applying. My first question is, what skills do you have that will help City Council successfully achieve its purpose?
What skills? I have a wide variety of skills, both physical and mental. My mental skills are basically all the management I've done, in industrial type management. And also I manage warehouses, different areas. Organizational is my key, and I like efficiency. That's my key. You know, I like the things to run smooth. I sometimes advise different companies on how to reorganize or how to organize their situation with setting up machinery and how the work should flow. So I think that can translate into city council, into the district council. So I think of that, but.
Any follow-up, Mr. Butler?
No, thank you.
Welcome. I'm short on words too. I'm efficient when it comes to speaking.
Again, don't be nervous. We're all in this together. Any other follow-up questions from the body? Okay, just do you have something you want to add?
Yeah, I would actually just like to add to Mr. Lesher. I greatly appreciate economy of words. So don't take that as that's not necessarily a bad thing.
Oh, okay. I didn't think it was.
He's also a teacher, so he probably says that to his kids, right, Chris?
I do.
I think he said it to me as someone who sat next to him for many years as well. So anyhow, but anything else, Chris, for Mr. Lesher here?
No, I'm good.
Thank you.
Well, we want to thank you for filling out the form, and we're asking everyone the same questions. It seems to me, unless I am not looking at this properly, that you have answered every question on this form. Does anyone see any areas that have not been completed? Okay, and we've asked everyone the same questions. We've asked for clarification in cases where it's been warranted. How do you see with the relationship between counselors themselves in terms of the interaction, as well as we all serve, and Marcia's touched on this with some of the other candidates, we all serve on various committees in addition to being here for the council meetings, committees of the whole. We serve as liaisons to various committees. Is there any specific area of interest that you have, should you be chosen for this position, that you would want to serve as a liaison to some sitting entity?
Well, I didn't mention this, but I do have a degree from Kutztown in a bachelor's degree in finance. And I enjoyed finance, but I think I could apply that to different areas. You have a parks and recreation area, or I noticed several different areas that I'm very diversified when it comes to almost any operation. So, but yeah, I enjoyed finance.
Okay.
I never had a job where I applied it. I graduated from Kutztown in 2003. I had started in 1988. So it took me 15 years to get my degree, which is basically unheard of, but I kept at it and I got it. And the week when I turned 50, 3 days after I graduated. So, and then a friend of mine had a limousine. I got him to take my mom, my sister, and my son to my graduation. And then a couple weeks or a week later, he asked me if I wanted to drive for him. So I drove for him a couple of times. Then he called me up. He asked me if I wanted to buy it. I didn't hesitate. I said yes. So I never really got to apply my finance degree, but I am familiar with all the workings of the finance.
And I assume running your own business that you need to deal with numbers.
Yeah, but I don't have enough money to count. So it's
are there any other questions from anyone? Marcia?
Yeah, and just because you brought this up about your concern about the drug problem, could you give any thoughts on what you could see the city doing differently as far as how we're addressing the drug problem?
I would go more toward, cracking down on the obvious dealings on mm-hmm. the street. Mm-hmm. I had one trip, somebody asked me, the person I bought that limo from asked me to do a trip for a friend of his or a friend of a friend. And I didn't realize this till later on. I was running drugs. It was, they had me stopping here, stopping there, stopping here. And it turned out that they were dealing drugs out of my car. And I didn't realize. I would shut it down right then. But, that was just, and I think the dealers need to be taken care of and help the addicts.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Anything else? Any final comments you'd like to make, Mr. Lesher?
I can't think of any. I'll probably think of a mountain parking lot when I leave. I know that.
Well, as we do with our other candidates, we thank you very much for your interest. It's commendable for all of you who have stepped forward, and we appreciate that. So we will be in touch. We wish you a good evening. And anything else here for the good of the order in general?
I'm the last one.
You're the last one.
You can all go home now.
There you go. Thank you. I think that was considered a motion to adjourn, but I don't think you can make that. Mr. Gumbar, I'll defer to you. Is there anything you'd like to add about the process and what we'll be doing?
So just to clarify or conclude, you do have 30 days from the date of the vacancy to fill that. So that would be February 9th. So there is some time still to do it. Based off of the process that you've used in the past, we do tally up all of these scores, and then that's a starting point for the discussion amongst the council members on who they are going to choose to fill this vacancy. Any official action does need to occur at a public meeting via a resolution. So a special meeting will have to be scheduled to do that, because you don't have any regular meetings at this time within that 30-day period. I know Mr. Butler does need to review the transcript from tonight's meeting to fully view the interview of Mr. Schlegel and I believe part of Mr. Nunez, so that he can complete his score sheet. So once we have all of that taken care of, then council can begin its informal discussion process about filling the vacancy.
Okay, anything else from any councilors regarding the process this evening? Mr. Butler, Mr. Daubert? If not,
no.
I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Okay. Okay, we have moved in second. So thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, our candidates, to the public who was here and watching virtually, and we will see what occurs. Thank you.